It's Supernatural with Sid Roth. On today's program, you'll meet a woman who was abducted by a serial killer, wanted by the FBI for raping and murdering 40 women. Hear her story of how God miraculously protected her from this madman on this edition of It's Supernatural.
3, 2, 1.
If it's not natural, consider it's supernatural. What if you went shopping, Kmart, you're coming back to your car, and all of a sudden, there is a gun in your ribs and a man that is on the FBI's 10 most wanted list, a man that has brutally killed 40 women that looked like you, said, get in the car. What would you do? Janie, there's 40 women, let's say. I'm posing a circumstance to you. How old are your children?
3 and 4.
Okay, you have a 3-year-old, a 4-year-old. The guy pokes his gun in your ribs. He's a mass murderer, and he says, get in that car. What would you have done?
I might have been paralyzed, or it's hard to say, or I might have screamed and said, somebody help me. Or I might have screamed Jesus' name so loud that to scare him, or I might have gone in the car because I would think he'd kill me. So I'm not sure.
What would you have done? Margy Palm, you didn't know, you did not know that this was a man on the most 10 most wanted list. You didn't know that this was a man that had brutally killed 40 women. I think he killed his last person just that evening before he poked the gun in your ribs. But still, what was the first thing that went through your mind? What was the first thing you said when this happened to you?
Well, the first thing that went through my mind was, I'm gonna die. And I could feel...
But wait a second, let me ask you a question. You're a strong Christian. Mm-hmm. You just prayed, you told me, that morning, mm-hmm. you prayed more than you normally prayed. Mm-hmm. Why would you have such a gross thought as that?
Well, first of all, you're made up of a body, a soul, and a spirit. And your soul is your mind. And many times you can have thoughts that are not in line with what the Word of God says. But the strange thing was that the next thing that came out of my mouth was, do you know Jesus Christ? And the Bible says that out of the abundance of your heart, your mouth speaks. And
what you had in you, I mean.
What was in my yeah. spirit came out of me. The thought that went through my mind was maybe a thought of Satan, maybe just a natural carnal thought, just because I had a gun, you know, poking in my back.
So what did he say to that question?
Well, I was shocked. I said it myself. And he said, no, I don't want to believe in Jesus. I don't want to do anything of the sort. Get into the car and sit on your hands. And he said, if you move, I will kill you. And in fact, the 2 a.m. the previous morning, he had killed a girl doing the same thing. She was in the car with him, and he shot her in the face and killed her, and then stole her car. I did not know anything about it. I hadn't been reading the newspapers. It was Christmas time. But I knew the man meant business, and he looked exactly like a character on a movie. He was a psychotic type of person, shaking, crying.
Beard?
And, well, unshaven. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I sat on my hands, and he put the gun right here in my rib cage in the car, and I began to ask the Lord within myself, what am I doing here? Why am I here? I mean, I love you, Lord. Why am I here? And I heard him say that he had put me there, and then I heard scriptures, very strong inside of me, and one of them was, I have given you authority over serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy. Nothing shall by any means hurt you. And the next one that came to me was, these signs shall follow them that believe. They shall cast out demons. And then I heard the Holy Spirit tell me, take your hands out from under you, put them on his head, and take authority over all the power of the enemy. Nothing will by any means hurt you.
Now, my last show, I told the guest she had chutzpah. Mm-hmm. But let me tell you, Margy, did you do that?
Well, I debated about it. You know, I sat there and I kept hearing these scriptures, and they became stronger than him. And, you know, I thought to myself, if this isn't God, I'm dead. And I decided that it was the Lord. I mean, the Lord had been training me for many years to hear his voice, and I knew it was him. So I decided to do it. I said, okay, inside of myself, okay, Lord, I'll do it. I took my hands out from under myself after saying to him, what is your name? And he said, my name is Stephen. And I said, I'm going to pray for you. And he said, no, you're not. I said, yes, I am. And I took my hands out from under me, put them on his head, and the gun was still on me. And I just, you know, I don't remember exactly what I said, but something to the effect of, I have been given authority over serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy by Jesus Christ. Nothing shall by any means hurt me or hurt this man. I am not going to die today. Stephen is not going to die today. And in the name of Jesus Christ, I command every single demonic force to leave him, leave my car, and I proclaim today that this man will be serving Jesus Christ before today is over.
Now, was that coming out of your spirit?
Yeah, it was coming out of my spirit. I mean, it was just blasting out of my spirit.
Sid, I have a question. I want to
know. Me too, but what's that? Well, it's probably the same one.
I want to know, why were you saying those words? What's words? Does it, something happen when you say those words? I mean, is there power in it?
Well, God's word is anointed with power. And, you know, when you're speaking words that the Holy Spirit is giving you, yes, you have power. Jesus' words are spirit and power.
So what did he say?
And,
I mean, after you
prayed,
what happened?
You know what I did? Right after that, I put my hands back underneath me and sat there like this, praying, and he said, lady, you don't have to sit on your hands. It's okay. I think, I don't know why, but I think I just want to talk to you. And then he said, I can't believe this. I'm in a car with a religious freak.
Now, I know that there isn't one person that's viewing us right now that will go away, so I won't tell you to come back. You'll be back right after this.
In a moment, you will find out why Margy didn't try to escape from this mass murderer when she had a chance. But first, this.
Well, Margy, now he tells you, this mass murderer who you... You really didn't know at that point he was a mass murderer. At any point,
no.
Did he tell you what he was?
He tried to tell me. He told me, I hate myself. I'm going to kill myself today. He did tell me that he said, we'll probably get in a shootout today. And I thought, a shootout? Who is this guy? But I wouldn't let him tell me. I said, I don't want to know what you've done. I said, I believe God put me in the car today with you for your future. I said, I believe Jesus loves you. Jesus wants to forgive you. And the thing about it was, I wasn't just saying words. After I prayed that prayer, the peace of God just fell into that car like a blanket.
But now I hear many people say the peace of God fell like a blanket. Best mm-hmm. you can. Describe what that feeling's like.
Well, the main thing I can tell you is I wasn't afraid. I had no fear. And, you know, I had a .38 caliber gun sitting
right
there.
Margy, that's not natural.
No, it isn't.
That is not natural.
I was not afraid, and I felt this unbelievable compassion and...
Do you have children?
Yes.
About how old were they back then?
About 3 and 4.
3 and 4. Mm-hmm. Didn't you think about them?
Well, every time I would start to think about them, I would just kind of put that over there, and I would just gear myself into what I felt God wanted me to do that day, and that was to yield to His Spirit. I felt like I had an assignment. that the Lord was giving me. And anyway, from that Kmart, you know, we went on to another point. And he said he wanted to go get a Coke, in fact, and that he just wanted to keep talking to me. So we went and parked the car. He parked the car at another point, and we sat there and talked. And he told me, he said, I don't know what it is about you, lady, but I've never felt this kind of love in my life. I don't know what it is. It's not sexual. I don't understand it. Are you an angel? Who are you? Why aren't you afraid of me? And I was surprised myself that I wasn't afraid of him. And the other thing was that I kept thinking within myself, I cannot believe the depth of God's love. I cannot believe I actually feel love and compassion for this person who wants to kill me. And I did, because he felt it, you know, and it that was the main thing. He told me much later that the reason, you know, he could do these horrible things with these women, he said they were so afraid of me, I made them, that I could make them do anything I wanted them to do because they were so terrified of me, but you were not afraid of me. And he said, that's what stunned me about you, and that's what made me listen to you, is you weren't afraid of me. And, you know, the Bible says there's no fear in love. Perfect love casts out fear. And, you know, he did ask me, why do I feel this? And I said, well, Jesus is not going to appear to you unless it's a phenomena, but he appears through his people. And the love in me is too powerful for your hatred. And because off and on, all day long, he would tell me, I have so much hatred, no God will ever forgive me for what I've done. You won't let me tell you what I've done. But there's no God that will have mercy on me. I'm too bad.
I would think anyone would think that. Anyone that brutally murdered 40 women would think God wouldn't forgive them. That would be a logical thought, but it's certainly not a biblical thought. What did you say to him when he said these things?
You know, I think a lot of Christians feel like that too. I mean, you can say God forgives people, but when you're sitting in a car with somebody that's trying to kill you, it's a whole different situation. And I guess the forgiveness of God came into me. I felt it. I mean, I felt God's the feelings of the Holy Spirit. I felt this incredible compassion for him, and it transmitted to him. I mean, he could feel that. And as I said, at one point he said, I feel more love from you than anyone I've ever felt, I've been around in my whole life, and I don't understand it, lady. And, you know, I just told him it was the love of God he was being confronted with. I told him that he said, I'm never going to go back to prison again. And I said, well, you're in a prison of hatred.
Why didn't he just let you out of the car then? I mean,
well, he over and over all day long, he told me he was not going to be able to let me go, even though he liked me. Because he said that he was afraid I would tell people about him and that he would be found. And I would not let myself think about who he might be, you know. Mm-hmm. I just kept my focus on the Lord, and I prayed a lot in the Spirit.
I prayed in tongues. That's a language that God gives you, that you pray not from the intellect, but from the Spirit, like Paul in the New Covenant said, I pray in tongues more than any man.
And I think in a situation of extreme terror, which there was, I was being, have been placed in a situation like that, your mind almost shuts off in your spirit. What's really inside of you, what's the guts of who you are, is going to come out. The spirit man is going to come out.
Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks.
The mouth will speak. And that morning, the Holy Spirit had had me praying 5 hours. And I know he had been preparing me, you know, spiritually. So I was built up spiritually. Also, previous to that, he had had me, I'd go off in my car and I would just memorize whole passages of Scripture. And I had an unbelievable hunger to just feed on the Word and put the Word inside of me. You know, and the Word of God says to be transformed by the renewing of your mind. So not only was it coming out of my spirit, but my mind had memorized so much Scripture that I had a lot of that already inside of myself, inside of my mind,
too. Were you able to lead him to the Lord?
Well, this was a very interesting thing. He kept telling me that the police were going to surround us somewhere along this adventure that we were on.
So there'd be
encounter.
A shootout and you'd get in the crossfire, if nothing else.
Yeah. And I didn't know there were helicopters circling San Antonio at the time. There were police going up and down the streets. He'd been on the FBI's 10 most wanted list for over 10 years.
Ooh.
And so anyway, I told him, I said, there are evangelists that go into prisons. I'm leading up to your question.
I know.
And he said, well, like who? And I mentioned the name of an evangelist, and he just seemed to latch onto that name, and the evangelist lives in Fort Worth. So he said, I want to go to Fort Worth. And I said, well, I don't know this man personally. And he said, well, I want to go up there. And so he was talking about maybe going up to Austin, then up to mm-hmm. Fort Worth, or going straight to Fort Worth. And while he was talking, I saw a road blockade. The Lord gave me a picture inside of a road blockade around Austin. And then he showed me a picture of a small little bus station in Kerrville, and I saw Stephen getting on a bus. So I told him, I said, the Lord has shown me this picture, and I said, we're not supposed to go to Austin. There's going to be a road blockade. And I said, we're supposed to go to Kerrville. Well, right after I said that to him, he said, I want you to go into the 7-Eleven here, and I want you to get me beers, paper, and cigarettes. And so I said, well, I'll do that, but don't make me read what you've done. I don't want to know mm-hmm. what you've done. I mean, I was beginning to get the idea he had done some bad things, but never dreamed that really, really horrible. So I went into the 7-Eleven, and nobody was in there except me, and it would have been very easy for me to escape. But again, the Lord told me that he told me, stay in this thing, stay with me. And there's a scripture in Romans.
Margy,
oh no, it's crazy.
Stay in this thing.
Yeah.
We'll be right back after this.
Stay tuned as this mass murderer's hate turns into love when he hears the audible voice of God.
Margie, you went in the 7-Eleven. There's a mass murderer in the car with a gun, killed 40 women, looks just like you, though you didn't know it, but you knew there was something going on. Why didn't you go through the back door of the 7-Eleven and leave?
Because I wasn't thinking like a human being. I was thinking like the Holy Spirit. But he kept giving me Romans 6:16, whomever you yield to, you'll be a servant to. And I knew that if you yield to the spirit of fear, if I yielded to the spirit of fear, something terrible could happen. And I just made a choice. And with God, everything is a choice. You have to choose to obey Him and choose to serve Him. And I chose to do that. And I chose to walk in what the Holy Spirit was telling me. And I went back to the car, and when He opened the paper up, He looked at me after reading the first little section mm-hmm. in the paper, and he said, this first section says there's a road blockade in Austin. How did you know that?
You had that word, that
yeah,
vision,
and
was
I
it?
had a vision about that. And I said, well, God told me that.
Wow.
And he said, well, now what else did he tell you? And I said, he told me that we're supposed to go to Kerrville and you're supposed to get on a bus up there. So, well, by that time he said, well, let's do that. So we proceeded up the road to Kerrville, and I happened to have two tapes by the evangelist I mentioned in my car. So we listened to that for a few minutes, and then he turned it off, and he said, I need to tell you, I have this son that I really love him, but I can't stand to think of him in this world. It's such a horrible world, and I've had such a horrible life, and of course, I mean,
your
the
heart
man
must
was,
have been going out to him at this point, despite everything.
Well, it
See,
really
I'm
was.
Curious about something.
What's that, Jimmy?
I'm just wondering if Margy ever found out why he killed a particular look. I mean, why that person?
Yeah, why did he pick someone that looked like you? What was the reason for
it? Well, I have a feeling his mother may have had a similar look, mm-hmm. and he transferred that hatred, his hatred for his mother, to women.
So, what did you
and
say
that was
to
a whole
him
other
about
story.
His son?
Well, anyway, I said to him, okay, you've been talking about your son. I want to ask you a question. If your son had committed the same kind of crimes you've committed, and I don't know what they are, but if he'd done exactly what you have done, number one, I want to ask you, would you forgive him? And number two, if there is a hell, would you be willing to go to hell for him? Would you be willing to die and go to hell? And he said, those are really hard questions, lady. And I said, well, I want you to answer them. And he said, you know what? I love my son enough that I, you know what, I would die for him. I would go to hell if there were a hell. And I said, well, Stephen, that's what Jesus did for you. And he said, well, you've been preaching to me all day, lady, and I finally understand what you're saying to me. And then we drove on for a while in silence, and then all of a sudden he started looking around my car, just looking all over the place, and he pulled my car over and stopped it. And the next thing that happened was his hands went straight up in the air, and he looked up, he said, Jesus, I'm sorry for everything I've done. Please forgive me. I want to go to heaven. And I was sitting there just in shock. And what he later told me was that he had heard an audible voice, and the voice told him, said to him, this is the last time I'm calling you. And he was looking around for it in my car because he said it was so loud, and when he heard it, he said he knew that everything I'd said to him all day was true. He knew there was a Jesus, and the Holy Spirit just fell on him, and his hands went up in the air. I mean, I never said, now repeat these words after me, nothing. And then he said, it's gone, it's gone. And I said, what's gone? And he said, the hatred, lady, the hatred's gone. And I'm so horrible, I don't deserve this. And he was just sobbing and sobbing. He said, lady, would you mind if I just gave you a hug? I can't believe this, this is really real. And I said, I know, Jesus is real. And then, you know, I began to relate to him the story of Paul in the Bible. And well, anyway, after that, we became friends after that happened. We started becoming where we could talk to each other more. And for instance, every time he'd cuss, he'd say, I'm so sorry I did that, lady.
So when did he decide to give himself up as opposed to have a shootout?
Yeah, well, we kept driving on to Kerrville, and at one point he stopped again. And he asked me to open my purse, and he emptied all the bullets of his gun into my purse. And then we went into Kerrville, and I thought, if they're in a bus station with a bus going to Austin, I'm in trouble. So when we pulled into Kerrville...
So the human side started
Yeah, the human side came out, too. So we found the bus station. It was very small, just like I saw in that vision. And when I walked in, I was, you know, as I just said, I was saying, God, please let there be a bus. And when I walked in, I said, is there a bus leaving anytime soon to go to Austin? And the man said, well, lady, the next bus coming in is going there. It's coming in 30 minutes. So I bought one ticket for him, and I walked out, you know, holding it like that. He was laughing, and I opened the door, and he said, don't tell me it's going to Austin. And I said, yeah, that's where it's going. So I got in the car again with him, and by that time, I mean, we sat and had a hamburger at a hamburger place, and
This is wild.
It's wild. It's the wildest tale. And I began to tell him about the reality of the spiritual world. And I said, you know, the Bible says the weapons of your warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. And I am a lot weaker in the flesh than you, but God has had me using the weapons of His Word. He's had me using the weapons of prayer. And look at the change. Look what's been happening. And he said, you're right. And he said, you know what, lady, I've never noticed all day what you look like at all. And right then the bus pulled up. And I said, well, your bus is here. It's time for you to get on that bus. And here I was telling him to get on the bus. So, he...
You said your goodbyes?
Yeah.
He got on the bus?
Yeah. And he said,
you know,
if I don't see you again, I'll see you in heaven.
Ooh, you know something, Margie? You know something? When he got on that bus, he gave himself up without any fight. He went to the electric chair. He was executed. But he went knowing his sins were forgiven and left a little fruit along the way. The warden came to make Jesus his Messiah. Do you remember what God told Margie? God told her to tell him, this is your last chance. I don't know if it's your last chance, but I do know this, it'll never be easier for you to make Jesus your Messiah and Lord than this precise moment.
I want you to pray with me, because it just might be your last chance. Say this out loud. Dear God, please forgive me for every sin I've ever committed. I'm sorry. I believe Jesus died in my place and rose from the dead, and by his wounds, I am healed and forgiven. I make Jesus my Lord. Amen. You know, if you said that prayer and meant it, I believe that you are as new a creation as that mass murderer, and you are forgiven. You are clean, you are pure, and I pray that God's Holy Spirit come upon you. And remember, if it's not natural, consider it's supernatural.